So, moreover, he is a son of great historian, Srikanta Shastri. So, along with his son, Dr. S. N. Bhagirath also to me. So, some documentary about the history and about the Srikanta Shastri. So, Professor S. Naganath served here in 39 years. 39 years as a faculty of English in the Central College, Bangalore, now Autonomous Faculty College, Bangalore, NIT. So, sir, not directly involving history, even though he collected his father's several works regarding articles of Srikanta Shastri, collected English articles of Srikanta Shastri, then Charitra Mattu Gandu Vivekala Itihasa, Source of Current History Volume 2, these are all the edited and associated with his father's work. So, and also they have produced a documentary about the watering of truth. It is in 18 episodes. You can see the website also, web address www.srikanta-shastri.org. So, I hope that you are enjoying the class of Professor S. Naganath, the son of great historian. Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Ladies and gentlemen, I stopped teaching 6 years ago. I retired in 2013. And that too from the National Degree College of Autonomous, Jaipur, Bangalore. Basically, I am an English professor. But being son of Dr. S. Srikanta Shastri, I took a lot of interest in history. Though I did not study history either for BA or in MA, still the passion remained with me. I am standing before you only as a son of Dr. S. Srikanta Shastri and nothing more. When I was coming to this building, I remembered an English proverb. We had a proverb in English, carrying coal to Newcastle. In England, Newcastle is a mining town. There is plenty of coal. Carrying coal to Newcastle is a stupid idea. Similarly, I thought, how am I going to teach history professors who will be there in front of me? I'm told 50 experienced history lecturers, leaders and professors are before me. You have taught history, you have studied history, you have taken it very seriously. So I can only give you a few insights into my favorite areas in history. Long time ago, I took interest in Indus Valley civilization, Rigveda, and at the same time, I got involved in a debate between Michael Witzel, professor of Sanskrit at Harvard, and David Frawley. You may have heard of him. This debate went on in Hindu newspaper. That provoked me a lot. I also had another ambition. I wanted to see my father's works published, reprinted, and available to the public. Long time ago, Mysore University Prasaranga published 5 or 6 books of my father. 5 books of my father carries Munnadi or introduction by well-known poet Kuran. K.V. Puttappa was my chancellor of Mysore University. He has written Munnadi for my father's books and he has praised his Bhartiya Samskruti very much. Dr. S. Srikanta Shastri, if he is not available to research scholars and students, nobody will come to know what he did in Mysore University. I will devote myself to Dr. S. Srikanta Shastri and his contribution to Carnatic history in my second lecture. My first lecture is on Aryan invasion theory, which is popularly called as AIT, Aryan invasion theory. There is also another alternative theory which has become quite famous in the recent years, out of India theory, that is OIT. So a debate is going on between AIT and OIT in different fields of research and inquiry. I have brought some books with me, and I have brought some downloaded articles also with me that may interest you to pursue this matter in real interest. I am approaching this problem from these angles. Number one, I am going to look at it as a linguistic theory. Number two, racial theory. Number three, whether Indus Saraswati civilization or Harappa Mohenjo-daro civilization, whether it is related to Rig Veda, Brahmana, Aranyaka, Ramayana and Mahabharata, the epic literatures of India. Because in Mahabharata and also in Ramayana we have history of various dynasties which ruled India. So it is partly historical. The epics are partly historical. Number four, how and when Indus and Saraswati civilizations were discovered and what impact it had on Aryan invasion theory. The discovery of these two cities and the theory, you know, both came into a conflict. Now, in the last 15 years, a new area of study has developed. It is called as archaeogenetics. It is purely biological thing. It is focused on genes and DNA and molecules and all those things. Genetics, they call it archaeogenetics. It is related to archaeology. Number six, the final big question before the world, decipherment of Indus script. Nobody has been able to decipher the script in a satisfactory manner. Jawaharlal Nehru once said, anybody who deciphers this script must get Nobel Prize. Though there is no Nobel Prize for history, but Nobel Prize must be given for the decipherment of this script, which has evaded any kind of decipherment in the last 70-80 years or more than that. Because Harappa was discovered in 1924. From then onwards, many attempts have been made, but unsuccessful. And also we have this question of Indo-European and Dravidian with regard to Aryan invasion. And that of course goes back to linguistics and language. This is what I have jotted down. Before we approach this problem, we have to remember, as students of Indian history, ours is a continuous civilization. It is whether 5,000 years or 6,000 years, it is one continuous civilization. Nowhere in the world, no civilization has survived to the 20th century. Chinese civilization has not survived. Egyptian civilization has not survived. Greek and Roman civilizations have not survived. In South America, the Mayans and Incas and the Aztec civilizations have not survived. Some of their languages have completely vanished. This is one thing unique about India. It is a continuous living civilization. We may call it Indian, Hindu, etc., etc. That's a different thing. first question is, who invented the Aryan invasion theory? Any idea? Anybody here? Yes, please.
Max Muller, that is linguistic theory.
And till recently, everyone was giving credit to Max Muller, who is supposed to have invented this theory in mid 19th century. But it is not completely true. Actually, it was invented by a Frenchman. I will come to that in a short while. It was a Frenchman who wrote on Aryans as a race and the superiority of Aryans over other races, and his book got translated into other languages. It even reached Max Muller, and of course Max Muller did not identify language with race, that is another thing. But later on, at the end of his life, he revised his views and opinions. With regard to the age of the Rig Veda, the date of Rig Veda, and also with regard to Aryan invasion theory, he had revised his ideas. I shall come to that a little later. I would like to start my lecture, in fact, with a quotation from Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Bharatratna B.R. Ambedkar was a Sanskrit scholar. We all know that he wanted Sanskrit to be the national language, not Hindi. A voting took place. Out of 100 members of the select committee, we are told 50 voted for Sanskrit, 50 voted for Hindi. The lone vote came from President of India, Rajendra Prasad. He was asked to vote and he voted for Hindi. So Hindi got 51 votes and Hindi became national language. But Ambedkar, as a Sanskrit scholar, wanted Sanskrit to be the national language. Everyone may wonder whether we can revive Sanskrit. That's a different thing. But Israel has revived the Jewish language. You know, it was a dead language. Hardly anyone was speaking that language. But today in Israel, it's the national language. They use it even for scientific research and everything. So Hebrew was revived. Hebrew language is the national language of Israel. Whether we could have adopted Sanskrit or not, now it is too late to decide. We can't do it. Ambedkar's quotation I want to read. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar had made a thorough and first-hand study of the Rig Veda and Avesta. Avesta is Iranian. He had examined the context and counted the frequency of the few words such as Arya, Dasa, Dasyu, Rudarvak, Anasa, Krishna Yoni, Varna, etc. He had made a study of it. This is his quotation within quotes. So far as the Rig Veda is concerned, there is not a particle of evidence suggesting the invasion of Indians by the Aryans from outside India. Ambedkar says this. In Rig Veda, you do not find any evidence for Aryan invasion here. So far as the testimony of the Vedic literature is concerned, it is against the theory that the original home of the Aryans was outside India. He had refuted the scholars' belief that the word Varna in the Veda meant skin color. He did not agree with that. In the original context, Varna does not mean color. In any of the 22 places, Ambedkar studied Varna in 22 contexts. Where the word had been used, his conclusions were, number one, The Vedas do not know any such race as the Aryan race. There is no evidence in the Vedas of any invasion of India by the Aryan race and its having conquered the Dasas and Dasyus supposed to be the natives of India. There is no evidence to show that the distinction between Aryans, Dasas and Dasyus was a racial distinction. Number 4. The Vedas do not support the contention that the Aryas were different in color from the Dasas and Dasyus. I have taken this from Ambedkar's book, Who Were the Shudras? Question mark, published in 1946. Now I come to a quotation of Jawaharlal Nehru. He is also an amateur historian. Discovery of India, glimpses of world history, all of them are well known. This is written to his daughter Indira in a letter. Can you not see them, within brackets, the Aryans? Can you not see them trekking down the mountain passes into the unknown land below? It is a reference to Aryan invasion, very romantic way of putting it. It is possible that the caste system was partly based on the desire of the Aryans to keep themselves aloof from the conquered people. The very word for caste in Sanskrit is varna, color. This also shows that the Aryans who came were fairer in complexion than the original inhabitants of India. This is taken from Glimpses of World History by Jawaharlal Nehru. So you can compare the two quotations, one of Ambedkar, one of Nehru. In the Sanskrit, as you all know, the word Arya only means a nobleman, an aristocrat, a cultured gentleman. In the Sanskrit dramas, plays, Arya is always used in this sense. And it came to be misused a lot, especially under the Nazi rule, when Adolf Hitler came to power. Adolf Hitler believed that Germans, the Nordic races, blonde hair, blue eyes, they were true Aryans, and who were to be exterminated? Jews, gypsies, and colored people. He was even contemptuous toward Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. He did not give an interview for about 4 months or so. And the Germans were inspired by another race theorist who lived in Germany at the time. When this theory came into circulation in mid-19th century, the Aryan invasion theory, we have to ask this question, why it was invented by the British or why it was propagated by the British? William Jones was governor of Bengal. He decided to learn Sanskrit. Till then, not many Europeans had learned Sanskrit. I think he may have been the first one. And he learned Sanskrit with very great difficulty because nobody was prepared to teach him. Brahmins were not prepared to teach him. He was asked to take a bath in the Ganges, come and sit in bed cloth and learn Sanskrit from a Pandit. Not facing the Pandit, he should show his back to the Pandit. And Pandit collected his fees and taught him Sanskrit in this fashion. William Jones translated Shakuntala into English. Then it got translated into other European languages. It was a great discovery. Sanskrit has rich literature. And Sanskrit fascinated them. And they found similarities with German, with French, with Latin, with Greek, and even with English. How did this similarity come about? German grammar and Sanskrit grammar are very close to each other. So they thought, we must tell these Indians that Sanskrit came from outside. It was brought from outside. So they said, Aryans lived in Central Asia. In Oxford, even today, they tell students it is Kurgan culture. K-U-R-G-A-N, Kurgan culture. I believe their burial system is same as that you find in Harappan, Mohenjo-daro. They say that Kurgans from Central Asia, steppes of Russia, they came all the way to India and they brought Sanskrit language. Then Rigveda was composed in India. But unfortunately, in the whole of Rigveda, there is no reference to any mass migration, journey, or anything. Now they have come out with another fantastic theory that only the male members of the Central Asian tribe came to India, leaving behind their wives and children. While I am dealing with the genetics in this time, I will tell you that. And this is another version. And the first they said, Rigveda was composed according to Max Müller, 1500 BC. Why did 1500 BC was given? Not many people know about it. If you study Bible, the creation of the world is described in Genesis chapter 1, Old Testament. They have calculated from the time of Jesus Christ backwards to the time of creation. According to them, the world was created 4000 years ago. And, you know, they thought everything must have happened after the world was created, after Bible came into existence, after Old Testament, you know, all those people like Abraham and Noah and Ezekiel came on the scene. So, they thought 1500 is a good date, safe date, after the creation of the world. So, 1500, Rigveda was composed. So, Aryans must have come to India 100 or 200 years before that. Then they calculated, they said Sanskrit language changes every 200 years. It is not a fact. And they said Aryanikas were composed in this particular century, Brahmanas, and then Mahabharata, and then Ramayana, and all that. This whole thing was purely a linguistic exercise. But unfortunately for them, Harappa and Mohenjo-daro were discovered. That upset all of their calculations. First, Cunningham took it for Buddhist stupas. But when they began digging, they found a township which went back to 4000 years. In some cases, it is much more older. So, what to do with the Aryan invasion theory? Did the Aryans come after the decline of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro? Or did they come when decline was just going on and you may call it a trickle down the Central Asia? Now they talk about a trickle migration. And what to do with the Sanskrit language? That became a problem. And what is the language of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro? So all this became intertwined. These are the words of some of the people who support Aryan invasion theory, but even they have doubts. First, I want to quote E.L. Paddy, the Australian historian who has written that book, The Wonder That Was India. He was in Mysore also a few decades ago. He visited Mysore University campus. A.L. Basham admits direct testimony to the assumed fact is lacking. Direct testimony to the assumed fact is lacking, and no tradition of an earthly home beyond the frontier survives in India. No tradition of an earthly home beyond the frontier survives in India. A.L. Basham. These are the words of another Englishman, P. Burrow. The Aryan invasion of India is recorded in no written document, and it cannot yet be traced archaeologically. Aryan invasion cannot be proved archaeologically. Kurgan burial custom with Harappan Mohenjo-daro custom, though they may be similar. in some respects, it does not mean the same people came here, because Aryan practices all over the world often resemble various cultures. We can push. It really cannot be proved that the Vedic Aryans retained any memory of their extra-Indian associations. In none of the four Vedas, and even in the Puranas, there is no reference to a long migration from a foreign land. Flora and fauna has, you know, changes, animals and everything, customs change, people change, there is no reference to that. And refers to the total absence of extra-territorial memory in the Rig Veda. These are the words of Max Muller. Max Muller said that the comparison of languages shows that the same blood flowed in the veins of the soldiers of Clay, Robert Clay. He says, the blood flowing in the veins of the soldiers of Robert Clay, as it flows in the veins of the dark Bengalis. They fought the war of Plassey, Bengalis. Bengali blood and the Clay soldiers' European blood is one and the same, because, you know, they belong to the same race genetically. That was his first assumption. He was saying that language is a truer sign of race, that is blood, than is complexion. In his later years, when it came to be generally understood that language and physical features are not necessarily connected, language and race cannot be connected. For example, Indians and even black people from Africa, Arabs, they go to Paris, they go to France. They learn French language, or they know French language already, and they become French citizens. You have Caucasians, the white Europeans, they speak French. People from Mauritius speak French. People from Madagascar speak French. People from Pondicherry speak French. But they all belong to different races. So language and race in India, that later on became language and caste, to what extent we have to study. In the Sanskrit dramas, women and servants use Prakrut, the noblemen use Sanskrit. Maybe by then it had degenerated to that extent. But at one time, Sanskrit was the lingua franca of India. When Shankaracharya in 7th or 8th century went to Kashi, or to Kashmir, or to Joshimath, he was not a foreigner, he could communicate. Even 100 years ago, many people traveling anywhere in India could manage with Sanskrit or Sanskritized Hindi. That was possible. Later, of course, Max Muller went back on his date of 1500 BC and said, it is older than that. Rig Veda is definitely much more older. We cannot fix a date, he said. And secondly, he disassociated himself from race and language. That is, Sanskrit identification with Aryan race. This is another interesting thing. In the whole Aryan equation theory, all the calculations got upset by another important archaeological finding. This archaeological find, I think you may have heard of it. It happened at Bogas Kivi. Have you heard of Bogas Kivi?
Bogas
Kivi. It's in Turkey.
Asia Minor.
It's in Turkey.
14th century.
Even now there's a temple there. There's a battlefield there. There they found a cuneiform tablet, and it was written in the Hittite script, King of the Mitanni people, King of Mitanni people, it is a Mitanni language, calls, you know, what is there on the cuneiform is, calls on his gods to guarantee his promises in a treaty. They were on the battlefield, but then they decided to enter into a truce. you know, they say that let us not fight, let us sign a peace treaty. So this is a peace treaty found in Boga's time. On his God's guarantees, promises in a treaty with the king of Hittites. This agreement is made with the king of Hittites by the king of Mitanni. The gods of the Mitanni, the Mitanni gods, you know who are the Mitanni gods? Are waving gods. Even though the part of the document is not in Sanskrit, language is not Sanskrit, it is Akkadian. It is Akkadian. What gods are mentioned in the document is Indra, Varuna, Mitra, and then Asatra. So in Turkey, you find a cuneiform tablet. It is in Akkadian language, and these gods are mentioned. So by at that time, the Rigveda gods and the Rigveda must have traveled there. And of course, I have the book here. I can show it to you later on. One person had made an extensive study of comparison of Rigveda with the Zendavesta, the Iranian Zoroastrian sacred book. And in Zendavesta, our mythology changes a bit, like Asura becomes Sura and Sura becomes Asura. There, in Zendavesta language, they have solar gods, sun god. They worship Mitra, Varuna also. And Rigvedic lines are there, hymns are there, almost word-to-word translation in upper Brahmshu form. In Navestan language, the original Rigvedic hymns are there. A comparative study has been made. That means, at some time, Rigveda traveled from India to Iran, not from Iran to India. Because from Abha Brahmshu doesn't come purer form. From purer form, the Abha Brahmshu comes. The name of the treaty is 1380 BC. That means roughly about 3,400 years ago, in Turkey, the Rigveda had reached. So it couldn't have been brought by Aryans from Central Asia. Sanskrit and Rigveda, they couldn't have composed it. The Indus Saraswati civilization urban phase is around 2600 BC. And decline happened around 1900 BC. I have a book here. It is edited by a very famous historian who won Infosys prize. And she has collected all articles written by experts on why and how this civilization collapsed. In fact, these are the important landmarks in Indian history. Sir William Jones's discovery of Sanskrit was in 1786. Discovery of Dravidian languages, Bishop Robert Caldwell wrote the grammar book, 1816. The discovery of Indus civilization, 1924. And Sir John Marshall announced to the world in Illustrated London News in 1924 about Harappa excavations. In all this exercise, of course, the time scale is very much important. If you take the time scale of the Harappan civilization and the time scale of so-called Aryan evolution, and the time or date given to Rigvedic composition, none of them match. They are always in conflict. Now, we look at this Indus Valley civilization. You know, it covers this large area, Pakistan, Western India, Northeast Afghanistan, Balochistan, Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Haryana. In the north, there is a place called Shahpur. Afghan border with Tajikistan. It almost stretches up to Tajikistan. And Sudan, it is near the Iranian border on Pakistan side. You know, up to the Iranian border, they have found these sites called nowadays called as Indus civilization. Totally, there are 925 settlements in India. In 1947, when India became free, we did not have even one. Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, and all the other sites were in Pakistan. And then Indian archaeologists like Esar-Rao and Bibi Lal and so many others began excavation, but they have discovered 925 settlements. In Pakistan, they have 475 settlements. Totally, there are 1,400 Indus Saraswati sites. The area is this much, 1,600 kilometers east to west, 1,400 kilometers north to south. Total area 1,250,000 square kilometers. No civilization in the world occupies this large area. Egypt doesn't occupy, Greece doesn't occupy, Babylonian, Sumerian, Roman civilization also doesn't stretch this far. 20 times larger than Egyptian civilization. What is there in India is 20 times larger. Now I come to one of the most important topics today, genetics and archaeogenetics of South Asia. Perhaps all of you know that man originated in Africa. What is today Ethiopia and Kenya and Tanzania. And 65,000 years ago there was a migration from Africa and we have all come from Africa. And these people, some of them came to India, they went to Europe, they went to Middle East. You will be surprised to know that the population which came to India also went back to West Asia. It happened 50,000 years ago. All this happened long time ago. And of course, this is a bit complicated. They have made genetic study in two manners. One, genes inherited from the mother and the genes inherited from the father. They have been studied. I just want to show, in India we had this theory that North Indians were a different race, South Indians were a different race. Urban Indians were different, tribal Indians and rural Indians were different. People who lived in the forest were different. Upper caste people were different, lower caste people were different. Upper caste people were Aryans, lower caste people, or South Indians were Dravidians. So we had all these assumptions. These assumptions have been swept aside now through genetic study. It is called haplogroup R1A1 as far as India is concerned. You know, they have made a calculation. West Bengal Brahmins have 72%. Gujarat Lohanas have 60%. Lohanas are agricultural community in Gujarat. You see, Brahmins have 72% in Bengal, 60% agricultural community in Gujarat, they have 60%. West Khatris, 67%. Ayyangar Brahmins, 31%. Chenchu tribals of South India, 26%. Tribals have 26%. Valmiki tribe of Andhra Pradesh, Yadava and Kallar of Tamil Nadu, they have again 17. Manipuris who live in Northeast, they have 50%. Punjabis have 47%. We think that Punjabis are true Aryans because Aryans came and settled there. They are all tall and fair and well built, and they must be the true Aryans. No, it is not so. They have 47%. In Pakistan, Mohano, 71% is Sindh. Baltis of Gilgit, Baltistan, 46%. This shows that the tribals living in India and the urbanites are interrelated. North Indians and South Indians are interrelated. Bengalis and Gujaratis are interrelated. So the earlier assumption is defeated by genetics. A 2011 study published in the American Journal of Human Genetics indicates that Indian ancestral components are the result of a more complex demographic history than was previously thought. According to researchers, South Asia harbors two major ancestral components, one of which is spread at comparable frequency and genetic diversity in populations of Central Asia, West Asia, and Europe. You will be surprised to know that they have found one gene which is in India. The same gene is there in the Red Indians in America. Red Indian migration also took place over the land. We don't know whether Indians went from here long time ago, 50,000 years ago. However, if one were to rule out the possibility of a large-scale migration, these findings suggest that the genetic affinities of all Indian ancestral components are the result of multiple gene flows over the course of thousands of years. India, according to Europeans and Americans and everyone, is one subcontinent with the maximum number of interracial mixture. We know that the Greeks came here and later Kushanas came, and then you had the Tartars and Mongols and so on and so forth. We have series of invasions that cannot be denied. Intermixing has taken place. You will be surprised to know that some business people, some merchants from our South India, from Udupi, they had gone to Greece. And there in Greece, there were selling Indian textiles and spices. The trade was in favor of Indians. And the Greeks said, we don't have any more gold to give you. Our gold is exhausted. You ask for something else, we will give you. This is on record. So the Indian businessman said, you give us wine, which we don't have in India. Good grape wine, Greek wine. And we want some 100 virgins. So Greek girls were brought to South Africa. They got married to this businessman. And intermixing of Greek race and Indians took place long time ago, during the Greek civilization. So we had trade with Rome, and there must have been intermixing of races as well. Epigraphically, if you go by epigraphy, the earliest reference to Aryan is found only in 6th century BC. We all know that the Buddha lived in 500 BC. This inscription is 6th century BC. Before 6th century BC, you don't come across any epigraphical reference to the word Aryan. It is called Behustun inscription, which describes itself to have been composed in Aryan language or script. The Aryan in this context means, actually it is found in Iran and it is in Iranian. They say it is Aryan language. The word Iranian also comes from Aryan. I told you in the beginning of the lecture, this was coined by a Frenchman. His name is Arthur de Gobineau, G-O-B-I-N-E-A-U. He is the one who started or founded the Aryan race theory. Arthur de Gobineau, he did it in the year 1856. And he wrote a book with a very interesting title, The Moral and Intellectual Diversity of Races. You see, it refers to races. The the moral and intellectual diversity of racism. Max Müller first mentions Aryan race in English in a book, Lectures on the Science of Language, 1861. He mentions the word Aryan in 1861. A group of Max Müller, he says, a group of tribes or peoples, an ethnic group, and he objected, Max Müller opposed the French historian, that is Arthur D. Gobineau, that is of mixing linguistics with anthropology. Linguistics and anthropology, it should not be mixed. And you know what this Frenchman wrote? He wrote another book called An Essay on the Inequality of the Human Races. The title is Inequality of the Human Races, held that Aryans were a superior race. This started in France. And Hitler's race guru, as far as race theory is concerned, was one Hans F. K. Gunther. In 1932, he was given, on Hitler's recommendation, a professor's post. He became a professor of anthropology in the University of Siena. And Hitler attended the first lecture delivered by his guru. So the race theory was very important to Nazis, and they propagated it. For the East India Company and for the Britishers to rule India, this was a convenient theory. They first said, your Sanskrit drama is influenced by Greek drama. Your best literature must have come from Greece. Why? Greece is the cradle of Western civilization. Greek drama, Sophocles, Aeschylus, all these people, Euripides, all are great playwrights. How can you have any playwrights like Kalidasa, Bhartrihari, Bhasa, and all that nonsense? So your Greek drama has influenced you, they said. Greek literature has influenced you. Sanskrit has come from Central Europe. Vedas were composed by Europeans. And your gods and mythology were created by them. Then came, of course, Alexander the Great and so many others. You have always been invaded. You are a second race. You are a subordinate race. You are fit to be ruled. You are inferior to us. So this theory helped them to establish a legitimacy for their rule. So this Aryan invasion theory has to be re-examined according to new evidence as well as genetics. I think I have consumed 1 hour. Now if there are any questions and doubts, you can ask me. I'm going to show a few books. And if you are interested, you can buy them. They are available online also. And they may help. I think this is the latest book written by B.B. Lal, former Director General of Archaeology. And he is the one who discovered Rakhigarh. By the way, I forgot to mention, when Harappa was discovered, it was considered as the largest industrial site, 300 hectares. Rakhigarh today in Haryana is 350 hectares, 50 hectares more, and there are still mounds. So India has the largest Indus Valley site today in the world, not Pakistan. And he has written a lot, and he mentions many Vedic elements in this civilization. For example, if you go to British Museum, South Asian section, they have Harappa seals with the swastika. They have discovered them. They were worshipping the people tree, the Ashwatha tree. And of course, they have identified Pashupata as Shiva and Mother Goddess, fertility goddess that is there. We do not know exactly what kind of a religion they had. But they definitely had a religion, and their head priest, the figure you must have seen of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, is wearing a vesti or shalya from right to left. Even today, all over India, all Indians wear shalya from right to left. Many things The man sitting in a yogic posture has been found on a tablet. So yoga was there in her appointment with the role. We don't know whether there was any homokunda, that is controversial. One group says there was homokunda, another group says it is cooking hut, it is kitchen. So that controversy goes on. Anyway, unless the language is decided, we can't be sure of it. It is a Bronze Age culture. Most recent finding in Rakhigarh is a bronze chariot and two skeletons, a man and a woman's skeleton. Bronze chariot was there. It goes to prove that we had horses. Horses in Harappan civilization is another controversial topic. And one Western scholar, a lady, says Vedic Indians did not know Samudra Sea. She denies it. This is called the Rigvedic People by V.V. Law. This is a wonderful book written by Naina Jog Lahiri of Delhi University. She has won Infosys Award, 50 lakhs. Finding forgotten cities. How the Indian civilization was discovered. She gives a lot of credit to Indian archaeologists who discovered Harappa, Mohenjo-daro and Kalibangan and all the others. This is her latest book, Naina Jog Lahiri's The Decline and Fall of the Indus Civilization. It is a collection of papers right from 1924 to the present day about various theories why this civilization died. According to some people, Indus Valley changed its course, Saraswati River dried up, and which is Saraswati River, that is debated. And in this, you know, I told you that something like 1400 sites are there. So how did it decline? Most surprising thing about this civilization is uniformity in their town planning. The size of the brick is same. Buildings, roads, baths, harbor, fortress, all they follow the same pattern. How could they do it? Whether there was any central administration, whether they had a monarch, whether they had a chief priest, we don't know anything. How could this civilization develop so marvelously and then suddenly it died, suddenly it disappeared? And there is a gap of 1500 years between 1900 BC and let us say 300 BC when Ashokan Kranti's grid comes arrives on the scene. This is not read by many people, but anyway, it's an interesting book because here different languages are compared, Mitanni, Hittite, Avestan, Sanskrit and all the other languages, by Srikant Talgeri, the Aryan invasion theory and Indian nationalism. This is written by a Belgian historian called Conrad Elst. Asterix in Baroque's Star, minor writings on the Aryan invasion debate. This is an interesting book edited by a foreigner, Thomas R. Troutman. It is called The Aryan Debate. He has collected all the important papers, Prof and Naganath. Aryan Invasion Theory versus Out of India Theory. Both are, you know, both they are represented. This is written by a Greek historian. His name is Nicholas Dezenas. Indo-Aryan origins and other Vedic issues. He has made an extensive study and he says there was harps in Indus Valley civilization. And of course, his is a thorough study. A Greek historian has written this book. We all know that Esau made an attempt at deciphering the script. It is not accepted by everyone. Aryan Mahadevan made an attempt and he called it Dravidian. He recently died. He was a 9 years officer. Aryan Mahadevan said it is proto-Tatar and he tried to prove it. This is written by a German fellow. It is available online. The inscriptions of the Indus civilization. And this is written by a man called Rainer Hassan. he has made extensive comparison and study and presents his case. You can go through it and you can decide for yourself, but I just want to read last paragraph of his foreword. The most conspicuous outcomes are surely the evidence for the use of the Sanskrit language and the existence of Hinduism in India of the 3rd millennium BC. The existence of a proto-Hinduism was indicated until now through a series of archaeological finds, but the text makes such clear evidence for this, and that there is no essential difference to the Hinduism of later times is surprising. He says, Hinduism found in Indus Valley and Hinduism of today, it is one continuous process. But more than this, the text contains unlimited valuable information about many other subjects which are very revealing not only for residents of India and Pakistan and experts of different fields, but also for every layman interested in cultural history worldwide. This is taken from Gregory L. Ocean's book. He is an expert on Indus Valley sites in Pakistan, and he comes from America and spends 6 months every year digging there. And he's top-notch world expert. Ayyavatam Mahadevan's paper is published in his book, Terminal Ideograms in the Indus. Here is one interesting work. This is developed by two scientists who work in Bombay. They belong to Tata Institute for Fundamental Research. They have made a statistical analysis of the language through computer. It is called Indus-Script, a study of its sign design, Nisha Yadav and M.N. Varga. Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Homi Baba Road, Kolaba, Bombay. This has been published by them. It is available online. And here is another one written by a foreigner called Aryan, a brief survey of work to date on the Indus-Script. What research work has taken place on the Indus-Script. Sometime ago in 2017, an article was published in Hindu. It was a very sensational article. This was written by a journalist called Tony Joseph. And he said how genetics is settling the Aryan migration debate. And he conclusively says the whole genetic study proves Aryan immigration theory. And this was published in Hindu on June 17, 2017. After 1 month or so, a rejoinder was written. This time it is written by two Indian scientists from Pune, and one K. Thangaraj and G. Chowbey. Two agreed to settle the Aryan migration debate, and they have given their reasons for it. In the first study conducted in UK, they have taken Indians living in UK and they have studied the genes. People who migrate to UK, they are from upper class and they are not definitely from tribal areas and all that. The representation is not good, not scientifically correct. So these people have found fault with that theory. Now I come to what the Priyashikhan Shastri has got to say. In India, some of the people who express doubt about Aryan invasion theory happens to be Dayananda Saraswati, first one. Swami Vivekananda expressed his doubts. And afterwards, Aurobindo also disagreed. Tilakan, of course, thought they came from Nagpur. And this is what Priyashikhan Shastri has got to say. This is the title of our documentary. It is available on YouTube. 7 hours documentary. Thank you.
as a meaning of religion, and he came to the conclusion that the Buddhist script and language was linked to other Buddha. He was one of the first historians, apart from Swami Vivekananda, and Sri Aurobindo, who state that there was no other nation of the Indian subcontinent. He wrote a series of articles on Indus Saraswati civilization, like the Aryans 1947, the Hieroglyphic Hittite and Proto-Indic scripts 1947, Harappa Tongva 1961, and Proto-Indic Arthur 1961. He also wrote in Canada, Dr. Bhagavad Sanskrit in 1938. Chandrabhagavata 1939, Prakya Bharatiya Samskrutya Vyakti 1946, and Harappan Mohenjo-daro 1962. It was Professor A.R. Krishna Shastri who suggested to Mr. Shastri that he must write a book in Kannada on Indian culture with special reference to Karnataka.
And the creator, Professor A.R. Krishna Shastri, told my father to write a book on Indian culture that has seen six editions, Bhartiya Sanskriti. It has become some kind of a cult classic. It is now available very freely. And in that, of course, the first two chapters deal with the prehistoric India from the anthropological point of view. Then, of course, he deals with Aryan theory and all that. My father wrote an article to the volumes published by Bharti Vidya Bhavan, the history of Indian peoples, the culture and history of the Indian peoples, volume 1, meaning age. In that, Dr. Shrikant Shastri's article is there on Aryan Dhamma. And in that, it was sent to Bharti Vidya Bhavan in the 1940s, and he says, it is an indigenous civilization bringing Sanskrit into India, and the proto-Sanskrit was developed in India, and he quotes from Atharva Veda, and he says Atharva Veda could hold true for the recycling of the Indus script. This was Dr. Shrikant Shastri's opinion on Aryan invasion theory and Harappan Mohenjo-daro, and he has written a number of articles in English and Kannada. And also, he has discussed it in his book, Proto-Indic Religion, published by Mythic Society, four parts. They deal with the religion of the Harappan Mohenjo-daro. How it has got similarities with the Vedic religion also. I will come to that a little later. Now, if you have any questions to ask me, to the best of my ability, I would like to answer them. You are most welcome to question me.
First of all, let me congratulate, actually, as a son of eminent historian, you are doing a wonderful work.
I am standing on the shoulders of giants, all these are giants, and we are all very ordinary mortals. These people have spent their whole lifetime studying languages, and many of them know so many languages, and it is a challenging task. As you read and read, I think as Indians we must be very proud of this civilization. I don't care whether it is Indo-European or Dravidian or whether it is completely indigenous or foreign. Let us take this civilization seriously. And to me personally, it is different from Egyptian civilization. Egyptian civilization celebrates death. They knew only mummification of bodies. Mummification of kings, mummification of cats, mummification of their servants, and their big pyramids. Their palaces are in ruins. What was their religion? Religion has not survived. What is their contribution to philosophy? Nothing. Greeks have contributed. In the field of mathematics and astronomy, Egyptians have contributed. You will be surprised to know that the gold found on Ramesses' mask. It went there from KGF. From India, gold went to Egypt. And the bodies, mummies, they were wrapped in cotton cloth. Cotton cloth went from India, from Gujarat. It was being sent from India to Egypt. And Cleopatra's son is supposed to have come to India. So Egypt and India had great links. And our spices and perfumes, they were going there. And modern Egyptian civilization, this Indus civilization is greater on any day. And of course, Europeans don't give much importance to our Harappan Mohenjo-daro. And in Pakistan, they have remained neutral because you know, they can't live with their past. And it is now claimed by American archaeologists like Bush. They have taken over archaeology in Pakistan. Any other question? Any other suggestion?
Again, actually.
Yes, please.
Sir, way back in some Mysore people excavated Harappa.
No, Mysore did not excavate. No, Mysore.
Mysore people excavated. Cemetery R37 was recognized with mature Harappa. But later, Cemetery R37 was recognized as late Harappan cemetery. And it was this Cemetery R37 which gave confirmation for Mysore people to say that Aryan invasion, to propound this Aryan invasion theory. Later scientific investigations showed that Cemetery R37 belongs to late Harappan but does not belong to mature Harappan phase. So theory of Aryan invasion was totally discarded by Indian archaeologists. So keeping this in mind, how does Aryan invasion theory still stand as far as archaeological investigations are concerned of till date? It's not accepted, but how still it is?
The question is, why it is still being supported?
Yeah, why is it still being supported and why is it still an accepted theory when it is an archaeologically disproved theory?
I can only go back to psychology. This has been observed by great psychologists. You find it among politicians also. They make a wrong statement and then they deny it. Or they try to stick to that statement and try to prove it is correct. Two things happen. In the modern media, because of modern media, they are televised and they are recorded, but still they deny it. Another kind of logic is Vikarta logic, that is, whatever I have said is correct, so let us stick to it. This theory was developed by Europeans, and it was accepted by them. And as more and more excavations and discoveries were made, they had to make alterations, they had to make changes. They went on making changes. Now the final hurdle or stumbling block is the genetic hurdle. You have one section of people supporting Aryan invasion theory. Another section, sometimes they say only Indian support out of India theory. So you have two groups of people. Who is right, who is wrong? So the debate has been going on. I think finally this will be solved only when the language is listening to the satisfaction of everyone. When we come to the land, when we come to know the language of this civilization, it gives a clue to everything. And that is not happening because we don't have a Rosetta Stone. That Rosetta Stone is there in British Museum. It was in three languages, and Champollion, as you know, the French historian, was able to read Egyptian hieroglyphics. And he said, this is this. Now we know how to pronounce Egyptian language. In many of the films like Mummy and others, they use Egyptian, ancient Egyptian language. But with regard to Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, the script is a mystery. And of course, Marshall's excavation, he found a dozen skeletons and then he thought there was a massacre and they looked for injuries and all that. There were no injuries, there was no invasion. Whether the fortress was burnt down, no ash, no carbon came, could confirm it. So that collapsed. So this wrong-headed theory is even today supported in Oxford and Cambridge. They do not want to accept the alternative theory, so the debate has been going on. Anyway, I think because it belongs to India, because it belongs to our past, and now the date is getting stretched, it even goes back to 6,000 years now. 4000 BC, easily 4000 BC. So it is 6000 years old civilization, and that is important to us. So we have to spend more money and more time. I often tell historians in Karnataka, our oldest Shastra, Halmini Shastra, is 5th century AD.
Yes.
I think we have to spend much more money and do a lot of excavation work. I am sure we will find inscriptions going beyond that age. Tamil Nadu is spending a fortune on explorations in Tamil Nadu. Sangam explorations and Tamil Granthi and all that they have been propagating. They are doing, but the history is important. For Karnataka people, history is not important. We have not seen these results for an inscription which takes us beyond Halmidi. Somebody has claimed recently there is another inscription which is older, but it is not in Kanpur. Any other questions?
Sir, do you find any kind of similarity in Aryanization of India and colonization of India? Aryanization of India and colonization. In the process, do you find any kind of
similarity? As a professor of English language in Maharaja's College, in 1969 and 70, we were taught about Indo-European group of languages. We have to accept that. These 9, now it has become 11, sometimes it is 13, languages that are grouped as Indo-European languages. They are different from Dravidian languages. Linguistically, they are different. Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, Malayalam, they are different. And there is a Dravidian language in Afghanistan, Brahmi. Brahmi is a Dravidian language. You will be surprised to know in Spain there is a Dravidian language. And that is spoken by a small population. So this is a puzzle. You know, how could a Dravidian language be there in Afghanistan? How could it be there in Spain? This is very difficult, but this is how language has been classified. If you take Indo-European language as the mother of all languages, all this becomes sister languages. That is Sanskrit, Latin, Greek, German, Armenian, Lithuanian, all these languages are sister languages. And there are similarities and all that. But Indian languages mean Indian languages. Even in Tamil, which is a Dravidian language, there are Sanskrit words. Recently I read an article, in Sanskrit there are Tamil words. Sanskrit speakers and Sanskrit users, they have borrowed words from Tamil. Malayalam has a very high percentage of Sanskrit words in whole South India. More than Kannada, they have Sanskrit words. Kannada has about 60% or 65% Sanskrit words. So you cannot separate Sanskrit and Indian languages. Bengali has, and you have other languages. Maybe Northeastern languages are different because you know, they are closer to China and Burma and all that. The Mongol Aryan race. Their language is different. And language is a very sensitive issue in this country. And if you tell that there is an affinity between South Indians and North Indians, it is difficult for North Indians to accept it also. So it goes on. Any other question? I think everyone is looking forward to a tea break. I want to tell one more thing before we leave. Yes, I will accept your question. In the next session, there will be more viewing than talking. You will be watching the documentary on Shrikant Shastri, the various parts of it. I will only mention a few things about his contribution to Karnataka history, which may be useful to you. Yes, please.
Okay. No, sir, I just wanted to know, Puratattva Koshala written by Professor
Shrikant
Shastri, is it still available?
Yes, sir. We have reprinted it. That is the first book on archaeology in Kannada.
Because Kannada
In this context, I want to mention in 50s, When K.P. Kuttappa was vice chancellor, he gave a call. He said, professors must write textbooks in Kannada. And Kannada medium instruction must be introduced. My father was one of the first history professors to write textbooks for students. Roman Chakravarti Patel Charitra was written for intermediate students. Prapancha Charitra Rupa was written for intermediate students. Vaisala Vastashilpa was written for BA students. And Purana Prashodana was written for BA students. It is our archaeology. Yes? You want? I am going to display the books, and those who want to buy also can buy it. Most of the books we are going to give a discount of 15%, except his collected English research articles volumes, which is published by the Linux Society. There are two volumes carry a price tag of 1800 rupees, but they give a concession of 400 rupees. So I can only give it to you if you want those two volumes for 1400 rupees. But other Kannada books and other volumes are with me, including sources of Karnataka history volume 1. And it will be displayed here during the next session. And those who want to buy, can buy it. Thank you. A votary means an exponent, or one who adheres to truth, one who values truth. We took about 2.5 years to make this documentary without any government assistance. With our own money, we have done it. We have interviewed 23 eminent men. They are all top people in Karnataka. People like Dr. S. Shetter, Dr. A.P. Srinivas, Dr. A. Chidananthamurthy, Dr. G. Venkatesubbaiya, Dr. T. V. Mehtajal Shastri, Dr. G. H. Nayak, and we have Dr. D. Shekhali also, my father's student. All of them talk about my father, and they mention several things. The chosen topic of mine is Dr. Shekhar Shastri's contribution to Karnataka history. Dr. Shekhar Shastri was born on 5th November 1994, and his birthplace is Nanjangud. My grandfather was a sub-registrar. He was a civil servant during the time of Narmadi Krishnajavadi. My father also spent 1 or 2 years in Mysore, but he had his story at Chikmagalur, at Kolar, and even in Bangalore. He joined Maharaja College in 1990 after passing the entrance examination. Not first time you read. In those days it was very tough. Perhaps you know Dr. D. V. Dutta failed in Kannada exam, 7th standard. Some teacher failed him in Kannada, such a great scholar. Dr. Shekhar Shastri couldn't clear the exam first time. He had poor eyesight, he did not have spectacles. But second time he wrote, and he was admitted to Maharaja College. We have covered that also in the documentary. As a student studying in MBA, he wrote his first research paper, Conquest of Siladitya, and it got published in a foreign journal. That is, the Journal of Royal Asiatic Society of Great Britain and Ireland, and it was published in 1926, 21, and it caused a sensation in Maharaja College, because it was written by a student. He was not a lecturer, he was not a research scholar. Later on, he was lucky enough to get the first research scholarship of Mysore University. And Dr. Shekhar Shastri is the second person in Mysore University to get the degree in 1949. He taught in Maharaja College from 1925 to 1916. From 1916 onwards, he was an emeritus professor. He received UGC postdoctoral fellowship. And he wrote his postdoctoral thesis and submitted it. During Dr. Shrikant Shastri's time, he wrote 120 Kannada articles. 116 English articles, 8 Telugu articles, 1 Sanskrit article, 1 Hindi article. So you are surprised that he knew all these languages. His mother tongue was Telugu, but he knew totally 14 to 15 languages. I am not exaggerating, there is proof. If you read Purana Prashodhana, you come across his knowledge of Hittite and Mitanni and so many other languages. He knew ancient Greek, he knew ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics, he knew German, he knew French, he knew many Indian languages like Prakrit and Pali. If you read some of the articles, he quotes from Pali. And in his geopolitics of India and Greater India, his knowledge of German comes through. And amongst the Indian languages, he knew Hindi, and he knew Tamil, he knew Telugu, and he knew Hindi, and he knew, of course, Kannada, and he was familiar with some of the languages like Ardhamangali and other languages. The North Indian Hindi dialects. Dr. Shrikant Shastri was, he never enjoyed good health because of smallpox during his childhood years. His eyesight, especially sight in one eye, was very poor. His hearing was poor because of typhoid. He was hard of hearing. He did not travel much. But he was interested in archaeology. He wanted to become director of archaeology, but he did not get that posting. He studied epigraphy, he studied numismatics, and he also wrote extensively to Indian journals and also some foreign journals. He participated in India's freedom struggle. That itself is an interesting story. We have covered that in the documentary. Two things happened during Second World War. The German radio corps, from Berlin, announced Dr. Shrikant Shastri's name and Dr. S. Radhakrishnan's name. His one book was reviewed by the Berlin radio. The title of the book is India and the New World Order, written by his student Y.G. Krishnamurti. And Shrikant Shastri had written the foreword, and that foreword was discussed by the Germans during the Second World War in 1942. He was arrested by the British Secret Service police in Mysore and he was interrogated. He also had the courage to write an article with the title, "Is the Monarch of Mysore a True Sovereign?" And the Mirza Ismail, Diwan of Mysore State, called him and reprimanded him. He threatened Shrikant Shastri with hanging. He said, "Maharaja has powers to hang you. You have written against Maharaja and you teach in Maharaja's college." My father said, "Maharaja has no such powers. He is not a sovereign monarch. He is a tutelage of British. And if he has got powers, let him exercise them." So saying, he walked out. His student, Y.G. Krishnamurti, was in touch with people like Jawaharlal Nehru, Radhakrishnan, Netaji Subhash Bose, and many others. We all know Haripur Congress session was a historic session. Gandhi's conscience candidate Pattabhi Sitaramaya was defeated by Netaji. This was opposed by Gandhi, and Nehru remained in the Congress committee, but 11 others resigned. Netaji Subhash Bose was forced to leave Congress party, and then he formed the forward block and he was expelled from Congress party. And Haripur Congress of India was published. First article in that was written by Shrikant Shastri. It is an anonymous article called Congress Polity. On the history of Congress Party, he has written an article. It is there in Haripur Congress of India, reproduced in the volume Shrikantayana, volume 2. Netaji Subhash Bose has sent a special message to this volume. It is there on the cover. And Shrikant Shastri was a close follower of contemporary events, and he was the first Indian to write Geopolitics of India and Greater India. Geopolitics was a new science at that time, and on that he wrote a monograph. Now coming to his contribution to Carnatic history, I would like to say these things. Maharaja Nalini Kumar Badiya had a talk with Sir Prachendra Nasi, who was Vice Chancellor of Mysore University. And he said, the history department of Mysore University must take up this project of writing the history of Mysore in several volumes. Please bring it out. Sir Prachendra Nasi called Professor S.V. Venkateshwara, who was head of the department at the time, and told S.V. Venkateshwara, your department must take up this project. Please write the history of the Mysore state in several volumes. Then S.V. Venkateshwara called my mother, who was a student. He had finished his MBA, and he said, you take up this project and you work on it. My father told S.V. Venkateshwara, the history of Mysore state is a narrow view. The princely state was a small thing. Let it be history of Karnataka. Karnataka had not been followed, but he said, we must write the whole history of Karnataka in several volumes. And then this scholarship was given for the first time by University of Mysore. J.C. Rollo was principal. He was unwilling to extend it beyond Bamiyan. And then my father threatened legal action against the principal of the college, and then he permitted it to work on it, and my father wrote this, submitted it to the university. The first manuscript was borrowed by Professor S.V. Venkateshwara. He took it to Madras, never returned it. In those days, there was no scanning, no xeroxing, no computing. So first manuscript got lost. Then he was asked to write again. Second time he wrote. And this time, Navaratna Rao borrowed the manuscript and never returned it. So two manuscripts got lost. When N.S. Rao was Vice Chancellor, he called my father and said, please write it for the third time, we will publish it. The book written in 1925-1926 was published by Mysore University in 1940. And most of the books of my father took 11 years, 12 years, 16 years to get published. Sources of Karnataka History is an important book from several angles. It was the first of its kind in India. You can read what in that book R.C. Majumdar has said, what Bode has said, what foreign scholars have, foreign reviewers have said. You can go through that. Second volume and third volume manuscripts are missing. And I'm still trying to find it. If I come across the manuscript, I will publish it once again. For your information, in Sources of Karnataka History, there you come across inscriptions or sources in six languages: Greek, Chinese, Tagal, Telugu, Sanskrit, and Kannada. Because he knew several languages, he can go to the sources and take it from six languages and write on it. He has written a number of articles. I do not have the book with me now, like the Devaraya II. And he has written on Basaveshwara. He has written on Purandaradasa. And he has written on so many other allied fields connected with Karnataka history. In this documentary, now we are going to show you how he came to write some of those things. You can watch it for yourself, and you can ask me later some questions.
And this one certainly adds to its credit. has scattered reports, inscriptions, copper plates, manuscripts on armor and whatnot. The author has promised to the great need of scholars that he will deal with the house of
In the international politics, you are not respected if you are not rich. Japan is respected because it is the third richest country. America is number one, number two is China. If you are not rich, nobody cares. If you are not militarily powerful, nobody fears you. And then all the other things come into focus. And these historians also went against the popular trends in those days. British wrote the first set of volumes on Indian history, Cambridge History of India. They wrote it according to their needs. And the Cambridge History volumes were not accurate or exact. And Srikanth Shastri and many others, they criticized it. Bharati Vidyabhavan under K.M. Munshi thought of those 11 volumes, the history and culture of Indian peoples from volume 1 to volume 11, and it has been translated into Kannada, and Srikanth Shastri contributed an article to the first volume itself. This project was taken. Today, Dr. A. Sundra is involved in a project in Mythic Society called Rewriting Indian History Project. And we have to ask this question whether rewriting Indian history is essential at this juncture.
Yes.
And of course, Karnataka history is such a rich history. In Karnataka, Sources of Karnataka History, Volume 1, I just wanted to highlight one particular paragraph.